Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I am your host, as always, Billy. I know everyone listening, this is 3 episodes in 3 days. What am I doing? It's because there's so many people I want to speak to, and the podcast is coming to the end of July 1st, so I need to squeeze them all in before I can actually finish up and, you know, go be a grown up for a bit until I decide, nah, fuck that, I'll just go back and record with wrestlers again. On this show, we're going to find out so many dark things, I'm sure, but I'm joined by another standout from Joe Hendry's wrestling school. For those that are audio listening, you're missing out so much right now. I am joined by Judas Grey. Welcome to the show.
Hola, danke.
So, I put out the call for getting a guest onto the show, and you were thankfully you contacted ourselves to say, is there any space to get on? But your name precedes you, as you were recommended as well. Ian Skinner recommended you about an hour after you contacted me.
My G Skinsies.
Yeah, you've had Sharky bigged you up as well. Pretty much all the guys from the school has. So I'm glad I've got you on, and I'm seeing the questions that we've got in. I think we're going to get on quite well as well, even after DMG. So a cliche question always starts off when I get a new guest on for the first time. How did you get into
wrestling? I wonder what it will be.
Yeah, how did you get into pro wrestling? What's got you hooked on pro wrestling?
So it's all over the place, to be honest, because my first actual memory of wrestling just tends to be this steel cage match between Jeff Hardy and CM Punk when, I would say, Hardy lost and left. But I know for certain that is definitely not the first match I've seen, because it used to just be, so we were never allowed to watch wrestling in my house. So we'd go to our grandparents and sometimes they'd just have it on, like we'd catch it on like the reruns. So it'd be me and my brother watching it. And that's just like vividly my first memory of it. And then a few years go by. So he leaves, well, I say a few years, probably about end of 2010. I got like my own iPad for the first time. And at this age, I'm like, what? I've just turned 10 years old. And I'm like, just going through YouTube, watching all these Jeff Hardy matches. And it was just really cool to me. So when I turned 18, I started looking for places to go. And at this point, it was like GPWA and Source were like the only ones, Reckless as well, but they were all really far away because I'm based in Edinburgh. And I saw Joe was doing this like little thing. And I was like, okay, it's like a live podcast. And I was like, cool, I'll go to it. I've never been to a wrestling show or anything like that because my friends aren't into it. My brother stopped watching it long ago. I was like, I'll go. So I'll go to it. And he starts asking people, and this just somehow works out very well. So he starts asking people, like, why didn't you become a wrestler? And I'm in the front row, and there's like four of us in the front. And it's like, money, money, time. He gets to me, and I was like, I'm kind of considering it. And this must have been like July, June of 2019. And he goes, cool, I'm actually going to open up my own school. And it just kind of all, everything kind of just fell into place perfectly at that time. So come September, he opens it up, and I just bought the ticket, got straight in. The only issue being I used to work on a Sunday, and I didn't talk to my work. I just went nope and told them hey. So I used to work at Sainsbury's, and I worked in the online team, and I worked in the evening. So I was like, listen, no, this isn't gonna work. So they bumped me to the morning shifts. So I used to go from work at like 4 a.m., go straight to training. And it was the worst experience possible. But it was like, it's equally like the best thing, because it's just, you start doing it and you start doing it as fun. And you're like, can I do this? And then you find out you're like pretty good at it. And you're like, oh.
Yeah, so I can. It was worth the 4 a.m.s to at least do it. As well, right. I'm gonna go right way back then, right to the start of that.
Yeah, I will tangent off a lot.
That's fine. I like a tangent. We like tangents here, it's great when I've got someone who's pretty new, because usually if I've got someone who's right experienced, I'll have like notes and matches I kind of want to pick up on and moments, and then if we veer off, I kind of try and get back onto it. But for yourself, we've got two matches, so it's fine. We can tangent all we want.
My bad. Right, what are you on about?
right back to the start of that, of Jeff Hardy's CM Punk. So I'm going to ignore the crushing, like, 2010 thing of making me feel really old, because I discovered Jeff Hardy in 1999. So we'll ignore that, because I've like, every time I speak to someone new and young, I feel old anyway. But so Jeff Hardy then, is he the guy you gravitate towards, or CM Punk, or is
No. So this is just a testament to how good Punk is at the time, and also how dumb of a child I was. It took me a very long time to realize wrestling was fake. So whilst the Summer of Punk was happening and everyone was like, fuck yeah, CM Punk, champ, I was like, fuck that guy. He made Jeff Hardy leave. So I was raging the whole, like, anytime any WWE game I had, I'd beat the living shit out of CM Punk. Like, don't get me wrong. Now I'm like, yeah, I fully appreciate that. But at the time, I hated him with a passion.
That is the power of Punk. Well, I mean, like, you're 10, 11 years old. I think you're allowed to do that. If you're the age you are now, maybe it's a bit weird. But you know, you like what you like, and you can be as, that's beauty of wrestling. You can be as emotional or unemotional as you want, as long as you're enjoying what you're watching.
It always confuses me though, looking back. It's the same as like Daniel Bryan being the vegan champ. It's like the message CM Punk was pushing was very much correct in that storyline. Don't, like, not at all is it wrong being like, yeah, don't do drugs. But it's Jeff Hardy, so
that's it. He was always the coolest, and I like that. Like I say, we're from a different generation of watching wrestling and watching Jeff Hardy, and he's still that guy that everyone gravitates towards, because it's Jeff Hardy. I mean, watching him now, okay, it's a bit sadder because he's a bit slower. He's a bit like, it's not great when you remember him back in when we first discovered Jeff Hardy, but it's still Jeff Hardy. So
I mean, yeah, I would go. We're speaking about it in work. Someone was like, "Oh yeah, like who's one person you'd go absolute?" And I was like, "See, if Jeff Hardy walked in right now, I would genuinely break down." Like, I love that man. Love that man.
He's gone away with so much in everyone's eyes, because again, it's just Jeff Hardy. Yeah, I'd probably be the same. I'm trying to think of anyone else. Maybe because I was an Austin guy over a Rock guy, that would be cool. I mean, if the Rock came in, I'd do the same. But like, yeah, Jeff Hardy would be the guy. I would just be.
Austin, it's funny because obviously I didn't watch him growing up. Mm-hmm. So, like, as much as I understand the impact and everything, the pop he gets from everybody, just it doesn't hit the same with me. When everyone's like, Austin's back against Kevin Owens, I'm like, cool.
I know.
Didn't really care.
Oh no! If you're my age and you came out in these knee braces, I was sold already. I was just that's the weirdest thing. I put it in a group chat going, them be working knee braces, and everyone's just like, all right, cool. Like, no, he's wearing his knee braces. You don't understand. He's gonna wrestle.
It's legit.
It's real. So Jeff Hardy. Then we'll just get back into the first question, because Ian Skinner did ask favorite 3 Jeff Hardy matches. So we'll just throw that in straight away.
So I spoke to him today and I was like, look, what am I judging it off? He's like, no, it's for you to decide. Because I was like, there's one, like the emotional factor that goes into it. There's 2, like the spot fests and the enjoyment. And then there's the actual, like, technical wrestling. And I was like, I'm just going to have to go off of the ones I enjoyed the most. And to be honest, it's very difficult, but Extreme Rules versus Edge, when CM Punk cashes in afterwards, that again broke my heart. Like, even watching it on YouTube, like 2-3 years later, I was like, he won a world championship and lost. TLC 2, because I'm just, like, it just is one of the best matches ever, isn't it? And if you disagree, you can bite me. And the third one, so I want to say the triple threat at Armageddon, because he won the WWE title, but at the same time, watching that as a match is an absolute mess. So I can't in my heart pick that. So I'll go with Undertaker, Jeff Hardy for the WWE title.
Yeah. Again, I was thinking, yeah, I had the same kind of thought. Obviously, it's yes, Undertaker, Jeff, 2002 Raw ladder match, easy. I'd throw in, if we're going tag team matches, Royal Rumble 2000, I'd probably put in there as well, the tables match.
The Dudley Boys one.
Yeah, when he jumps off the car at Madison Square Garden, go for that. And then if it's singles, I'd even put in against Randy Orton, 2008 Royal Rumble. I think it was, that was his first chance at the WWE title. And he was like,
when he was in Intercontinental Championship. And that's like the famous picture. Randy spins out the twist of fate.
That's the one. That was, I stayed up to watch that. And I was one of the first few times I'd stayed up. I was like 17 at that point. And I was watching it going, oh, this is the best thing ever.
I mean, build up for that was great. Like Jeff swantoning off the stage and everything like that. Just chef's kiss.
Absolutely. And then just as a wee like bonus, I don't actually remember the match. I just remember being so excited as when I got to see Jeff wrestle live in Aberdeen, just because it was just seeing him wrestle. I was like, oh my god, this is the best thing ever. He's there, I can see him, I could probably touch him if I ran fast enough. But yeah, it was like John Morrison, Shelton Benjamin, Carlito, and Jeff Hardy in a four-way. So, you know,
I mean, it's definitely a good match.
Yeah, you just have to take my word for it.
I'll believe you.
But no, definitely Royal Rumble 2008, I'd put up there. Like you're saying, the triple threat for sentimental purposes, but yeah, wasn't the best match at all. You're right. It's the ladder match of Undertaker. I don't know how it's still so good now, because I watched it recently. Because I watch it when I need to pick me up, I'll watch a Rumble or watch like that match. And it's just like, this shouldn't be that good 20 years later. It's like, but it's still as emotional as it can get. It's ace. All fantastic choices, and from yourself, and also my regret as well, so people can just take their word take my word for it. So Jeff Hardy, CM Punk, hate CM Punk, Jeff Hardy. So I suppose right about that time, like I'm saying, Austin Rock, that wasn't your kind of scene because you weren't alive for it. That time would have been Cena Orton, maybe? Would that be your kind of like equivalent?
So by the time I actually was watching it on like a regular basis, it was probably around the time the Shield was getting pushed in. Yeah. So I knew all about, like, I had a friend who loved John Cena and like obviously knew about Cena and Orton. But I think at this time it was probably more like the coming to the end of that, and it was more the Shield being pushed, and then obviously CM Punk and The Rock, and then like Cena and The Rock and everything like that. So it was definitely more CM Punk's time, which is why it irked me so much more at the time, being like, god damn it, this guy is like the centerfold of it. And then obviously John Cena and Rock came along and went, get.
Yep, and then Punk went away for years. Well, I mean, according to him, he stopped wrestling in 2005 anyway, so there's just a figment of our own imagination. So you met Joe. Well, you went to the Joe Q&A. So being in Edinburgh, though, were you aware of a Scottish scene in general? Because then it would have been Discovery started in 2015, I think it was, and W3L would have ran shows in Edinburgh, and ICW would have as well. You would have been too young for that. But were you aware of a scene round about Scotland?
So I'd literally, up until I started looking at Scottish wrestling in about 2018, I had no clue about it. I'd seen Grado before. I'd seen him in like TNA and stuff like that as well, but I'd literally not a clue. So it was quite fun for me being able to like watch ICW on YouTube and be like, oh crap, like this is like a big thing, and I just, I'm not aware of it, and it's in Glasgow, and it's just, it's happening. And then it made me more aware of like, okay, there's actually like schools. Unfortunately, there wasn't one in Edinburgh at the time, but I was like, okay, there's Reckless, there's GPWA, there's Source. Those are like the main three I was looking at, just in terms of ease of access of getting to, they were probably the easiest. But it was like, I had literally no clue of any Scottish, outside of Drew McIntyre and Grado, that was all my knowledge of Scottish wrestling.
I'm so intrigued about how your first kind of Grado thing was through TNA, and he'd been doing the same act for years.
So elsewhere. It wasn't through TNA. Like, I definitely had seen him earlier because he got plastered everywhere in Scotland. Like, I'd seen him probably doing some random, like, morning TV show or something like that. And I was like, oh, cool. Scottish wrestler. Funny lad. But when I saw him on ICW, like, on YouTube and everything, I was like, oh, okay. This makes a lot more sense now. Why this guy is so big and everyone in Scotland seems to know who he is but me.
So what was your kind of rabbit hole then? You said ICW and you got introduced to that. Was there any, being of a YouTube generation, was there any particular things that you gravitated towards when you were looking through outside of a Jeff Hardy matches? Was it old TNA? Was it modern stuff? What was your kind of vices?
So once I eventually moved on from my Jeff Hardy era of just watching those matches, for a long time, especially when I was looking to get into it, it was very much the death matches and stuff of ICW more particularly. Because although I'm not a death match kind of fan, I'm a, like, I love a gimmick match, you know, anything, Hell in a Cell, steel cages, anything like that. So ICW putting on, like, having on this catalog of insane matches of people doing, like, mental stuff. I was just like, cool. And I just kept going down a rabbit hole of all these matches. And I was like, don't want to take a tack bump, but I appreciate that you did it, you know?
Yeah, okay. Yeah, so you appreciate the art. You don't want to be the artist in that particular of thing. Yeah. Well, what's your kind of pain threshold for that kind of stuff? Is it just, is bumping enough for you? Or do you ever look at a light tube whenever, I don't know, when you'd ever see one, at an office maybe? You don't really see a light tube in the wild. But if you ever see one, you go, what if I crack that off my back?
It's not even like the pain of it. It's more, it's the same with blading. The thought of actively having to like pierce my skin for it freaks me out. Like, I love horror films, but the things that get me in horror films is always like the small things. Like in Friday the 13th, the remake, someone gets like the machete through their hand and it was just like, oh, that must suck. But then I can watch Saw and someone gets their head trapped or ripped apart and I'm like, oh, cool. So like tacks and stuff like that, it's like the thought of not even like a bunch, just having one, you know, like you get up, you've somehow gone unscathed, you sit down, and then it's that Chris Jericho effect of like, I've just been stabbed in the arse by a random tack like that. Oh, I don't like it. But to be honest, I'd probably be, as much as I'm saying this, like if someone goes, hey, we've got this sick match, it's going to end with a tack bump, I'd be more, if I have to keep bumping after that, no, no.
That is the end.
Yeah.
I get that. I'm not big into, I hate horror films. It's just, does not do it for me. It does it at all. I don't like jump scares or anything. That's just not my vibe. But like the thought of that, like all the other stuff, I'm like, oh, no, it's not real. But for example, I would see something just like a toothpick or that going underneath a nail, I'd be like, oh, yeah, no, that would be too far. Oh yeah, chop someone's leg off. You know, that's a big bump. That's a big thing. That'll suck. But you're just under the nail. It's just painful enough for you to not like it, but also not painful enough for you to die.
I just have to suffer with this now.
Exactly. That's it. Oh, but I'm going to be checking my seats every time I sit down now after the old attack. Is it weird watching wrestling when you're young and nowadays where thumbtack is more used term? And drawing pins, it just doesn't roll off the tongue the same when someone takes out a bag of drawing pins.
I still, like, in my head, like, I'm convinced I'm saying, like, I'll be like, oh yeah, is there thumbtacks? I'm like, wait, no, they're not called thumbtacks. Wait, no, they are. Wait, and then I have to like Google it to make sure I've not like completely like fooled myself in my head. I'm like, no, yeah, thumbtacks. They are the correct thing.
But I mean, thumbtacks makes more sense. But I suppose I'm guessing drawing pins were used for like, I don't know, thread and whatnot, and something for drawing bases, for drawing straight lines or some shit. I don't know. But yeah, thumbtack just makes more sense. It's one time the Americans have oversimplified something where it actually makes sense when they do words. Things like when they, instead of using glasses, it's C and I glasses. Like, of course it fucking is. That's what you use it for. So, you know, it's one time I'll forgive them for oversimplifying something. Thumbtacks makes more sense. Right. So from that point onwards, then you started, we kind of mentioned a little bit of pain threshold, but what was that first couple sessions like? What was your kind of, what was your sport background before trying pro wrestling?
I didn't really have much of a combat sport or anything like that. I just, as every kid does, football. I never did it, but I was really into gymnastics. I did dancing as well, so decent hand-eye coordination, and you know. But that was pretty much it. Like, I managed to teach myself how to do handstands and nip-ups and all that stuff just because I watched High School Musical and was like, hey, yo, that guy did some flippy stuff. I want to learn that. And it just, like, one day I spent this day on the grass just practicing it. And I was just like, oh, cool, I can do it now.
Right, this wrestling podcast is cancelled. We're talking about High School Musical now. So I didn't think anyone would ever bring it up, but I have, they're my guilty pleasure movies. Like, no, I shouldn't like them.
God, no. I mean, the second one, the song I Don't Dance when they're doing the baseball game,
yeah,
that's like peak. That is the best one. You can argue with me all you want, but that is the best song in it. But the meme where they're all in the kitchen and like banging the pots and singing, the yeah, video of that without the actual music is the single greatest thing I've ever seen in my entire life.
Hey, I'm putting out there, Bet On It is my favorite song from High School Musical 2. I love it. It's so ridiculously teen angsty for no reason, and it gets so dramatic so quickly, and it's just the best thing ever. It's, and I don't know, for years later, of course, watched Greatest Showman, and what's the song with Zac Efron and Hugh Jackman?
Oh, the one when they're in the bar.
Other Side.
That's a top-tier song as well.
I love that song, and it took me a long... Well, I watched it, I love that. So that's my favourite song. My wife turned to me and went, it's just Bet On It. That's what the song is. That's why you like it, because it's just a grown-up version of Bet On It. And I listened back going, God damn it, she's right. It's just a grown-up version of Bet On It. That's what The Other Side is. And it's,
I'll have to watch it again. But my only, like, my vivid memory from The Other Side is there's the scene where they're taking shots, and there's a shot on top of the piano where Zac Efron completely misses the shot and has to, so he's like singing and he just goes, fuck, has to grab it again. And like, I don't know why, but it's like the one thing, I saw it like three times in cinema just because I actually adore that film, I'm not gonna lie. And that's just the one thing that always stood out to me, and it always really irked me. I was just like, god damn it.
That's I don't know how we've somehow stumbled into a great tangent, which I'm really gonna find it hard to come out of. But no, I never saw it in the cinema. I'd see it on Blu-ray because it was one of those things where it was right, I get married around about the same time, and I was like, oh, me and my mum will go see this, and this will be kind of like part of our little, because it did little wee things throughout before the wedding. And I was like a child. I was so disappointed because I wanted to see it so much. They're like, no, it's just the mums that are going. And I'm sitting there going, but I want to go see it as well.
I saw it because it was, so when I was with my ex, I think it was like our 1 year anniversary, and it was, the tradition was we're going to go to watch musicals. So our first day we went to see La La Land, which I thought was absolute garbage. And the best part about this, like, this is off it, but still, I'm walking down the stairs in a full cinema, like proper, and it's the big, big screen as well. And I get to the final step and I trip. I saved myself, but I tripped, and it was dead silent. Like, the film, I don't remember what point it was at, but dead silent in the whole cinema. Everyone just saw me trip. I went, fuck. Everybody just broke out laughing at me tripping on this. I just had to awkwardly walk to the bathroom and walk back in. And I was like, don't trip, don't trip, don't trip, don't trip, the whole way up. But then we went to see The Greatest Showman, and I didn't even see advertisements for it anywhere. And my ex was like, oh, no, we'll go see it, we'll go see it. And we saw it, and I was like, oh, damn. That was actually very good. I very much enjoyed it. I think I ended up enjoying it a lot more than she did. And I was just telling everyone, like, it's class. It's a great film. Top tier.
Amazing. Right. I like a bit of musicals as well. I don't see as many up here. Last one I might see was Book of Mormon a couple of weeks ago. Which
never even heard of it. I hate to break it.
That's all right. It's written by the guys that did South Park, Trey Parker and Matt Stone. And I've only heard beforehand, I'd only heard like the first song, which is the one they play on every like thing if they're talking about Book of Mormon. It's very clear afterwards why, because that is the cleanest song in the whole film, the whole stage show, because it's fucking wild. It's just it's insane. Other than that, Footloose is a little one I've seen on stage, which I quite liked. Garth Gates was the lad who can't dance in it, which was a bit weird.
I've never seen a musical like live. I've seen the films I've watched, like this year I watched the Bo Burnham Inside, which I don't know if that really counts as a musical, but like in my head it does. And the film Andrew Garfield was in, the
Tick Tick Boom.
Yes, oh, and I had that Happy Birthday song stuck in my head for ages. And I just like would be playing Xbox with my mates. And I'm just like, happy birthday. They'd be like, shut up.
Hamilton is also quite a high favorite. I haven't seen it live, but I watched it on Disney Plus when like the day it came out. And my wife now just plays it constantly in the mornings, which is getting ready. So I know most of the words now. It's just I love a good tune it's just nice. It's not like big screamy music. It's just like
I listen to my fair share of that, to be fair. So I can't look like this and not listen to some sort of screamo, to be honest.
So before we move off musicals in general, I'm just gonna just throw in a question for Mr. Manival. He has asked if just randomly. I don't know how to fit this in any other point. If Cher was an M&M flavor, what do you think she'd be?
He's going to be offended, but I'm going to say crispy because she's not top tier. She's not chocolate, and she's not peanuts. Peanuts are absolute ass. And anyone who eats peanuts are wrong.
Crispy's my favorite, so I'll.
That is not top tier. That is the incorrect choice. It is chocolate.
I am. Very average. I'll go with that. I'm a basic bitch when it comes to my M&Ms. Give me some crispy and I'm happy. Put them in the fridge for an hour.
It's just well known that all I do is eat M&Ms. And it's just the joke amongst everyone because I just show up and I do stupid stuff and just go to the gym and they're like, fueled by M&Ms and all that protein. And it's only recently where my diet's gotten better into actually eating protein. And even then, I'm still not eating what my goal should be. And they're just like, at least it's not M&M's. And I open my bag and it's like a full bag of M&M's.
Right, M&M's then. So, of course, I'm assuming you've dived into the American candy stores and all that kind of stuff to get all the fancy ones.
Actually, I did go to, there's a store in Edinburgh called Kingdom of Sweets. And I heard they did it. And I went in one time to try it, like find them. And could not find the section at all, and I was far too embarrassed to go M&M's. So I awkwardly walked around and awkwardly walked back out.
Yeah, I mean, there's some. I had birthday cake ones for my birthday one year, because you know why not? Tasted like every other M&M's I've ever tasted, so that was not worth like whatever £3.50 for a packet because it's American. That was awful. We've got chili ones downstairs, chili chocolate ones.
Oh God, no!
I don't. They taste fine, and then the chili arrives, and you're like, why have I done this to myself? This is the most ridiculous thing ever.
Why would someone think that's a good idea?
Americans, that's who. This is not a great podcast if you're American. We're just, I'm just going to slag you for a good amount of time.
I mean, half of my humor is either slating Americans or slating anyone above Queensferry, because, I don't know, the humor inside of Edinburgh, or at least the school I went to, was anyone from Fife is just slated. So I'm sorry.
That's all right. I mean, I'm up in the northeast. I'm between Aberdeen and Inverness. I'm where Ian Skinner grew up. I'm in Elgin. I just realized I said that. I was like, that's not going to help me, my case at all as a human. But yeah, so that's where I live. But oh, beautiful kingdom of Fife. You can't say Fife. It has to be beautiful kingdom of Fife.
Do you want to know a fact about Fife? And look it up, because I said this to someone and they looked it up as well.
Right, Googled.
And they said it was true. So Fife isn't the place in the world where you're most likely to get stabbed. But if you do get stabbed in Fife, it is the place where you are most likely to get stabbed again. I don't know how you searched that up, but that was a fact I saw on a comedian's show one time.
I don't know. Yeah, I don't know where to start with that, because I'm using my work PC under Google here. I would just put Fife stabbing twice just to try it. Fife woman jailed for stabbing man's bum for trying it on. That's a good start. Boy 17 stabbed twice in the head, you know.
Well, they're all twice at least, but you did search twice, so.
True, that is fine, yeah. Well, that's an interesting fact, you know. I mean, this podcast is educational. Weird, but educational at the same time. Right, I don't even know where to go from that. We've went from stabbing to all that kind of stuff. So, you started training. You had a little bit of a background in sport, of some stamina at least, and you said hand-eye coordination, you got a bit of rhythm going at the very least. So that's all good stuff to go into wrestling with. How were you introduced to just the Q&A for Joe Hendry then? If you weren't aware of a UK scene, was it just his appearance as an impact?
So I'd seen, whilst I was doing all the research on like ICW and stuff, I came across Joe's videos of how to be a pro wrestler. And like, started following him on Instagram and stuff, and I think he just announced it on that, and it was like, it's in Edinburgh, and I was like, oh, okay, cool. And my ex luckily pushed me to do it. She was like, just go. Like, I hated it as well, and it was in this club, and I cannot remember the name of the club for the life of me. I know where it is, but can't remember it. And we go in, and my fear was like, they're gonna ID me, but I'm like, at this point, don't think I had my ID with me. And I was like, fuck. But they let me in, luckily. And I just, that just so happened to be, well, I ended up going there and like session with Martina, Dave, I think G Money, Sam Barber were there. I've later found out that Ian was also there, but hiding in the back. So.
Gulkin, like a troll in the darkness.
Exactly. The goblin he is.
Right. Training then. So how did you find your first couple of sessions then? How did you think it was for you? Well, obviously you thought it was for you because you're still doing it, but like, was there any hesitation at that point, or once you started you were like, yeah, I can do this?
So our first couple of sessions, or at least from my memory, are like, they were all the basic stuff. So I think because it was his first class, he didn't want to rush anything, so it was like 200 lockups. Like all lockups. And I think the point I realized was like, yeah, I actually quite enjoy this, was when I've done a full session of lockups and actually enjoyed myself. But all I had to say before it was, I can go.
I know. So you go, oh, I'm doing wrestle training. What have you learned? That's it.
Collar and elbow tie up. Bye.
I'm ace at them. Do you do anything else? No. That's no. All I've got.
Everyone had like so many bruises though, because obviously you're learning it and everyone just kept kind of chopping collarbones. So it just had massive red marks from getting absolutely sliced by people.
So a couple of sessions in then, you're learning more stuff as you go along. Was there anything... When did you start? Because I'm assuming it wasn't long before the actual
lockdown started. It was September 2019, like late September 2019, and then it was just every week. It was supposed to be like an 8-week thing from there, and it just kind of went on up until lockdown, and then obviously that's when it all got shut off. So
yeah. So that was March 20th then. So at that point you would have had five months, approaching 6 months of actual training. How did you feel at that point? How did you feel you were progressing at that point? Was it just like you were just ready to go, or was it still kind of just a bit at a time you were finding with Joe?
Well, I definitely wasn't show ready at all. Promos were, and probably still are, my worst attribute. Then it was more the lack of confidence and what to say, and I'd get nervous, so I'd swear, and he'd be like, "Can you do that?" And now they've, you know, drastically improved, but it's still definitely my worst thing. But you just got to work on it. But like the movements and stuff always felt kind of came quite easily to me. So at this point, I probably could have been a good jobber on a show, but I was not anywhere near the caliber I am now at all.
So lockdown arrives, March 2020, and we all got sent home. Some of us just never left the house again. Me. And then started a podcast because, you know, everyone else did. How did you cope with that? So, because you said you were working in retail, and were you still at Sainsbury's?
I worked at Sainsbury's. I moved to my grandparents, where basically because they're older, I was like, yeah, they're older. Can I get time off? And they're like, yeah. So anyone who like lived with a vulnerable person got like 5 months off. So it was 5 months of me just playing my Xbox, which was great fun. Getting paid for it as well. It wasn't that bad for me at that point. I didn't go outside or anything like that. Because like I followed the rules very well, especially at that time. So it was just mostly sat around doing nothing. I did miss going to the gym, but that was about it, to be honest. Like I found the first lockdown very easy to cope with. The second one sucked, but
you got 8 o'clock each Thursday, beer clapping. And that was your fresh air for the week.
Some people did it here. I don't think most people did. But I was never awake at 8 o'clock.
Or some of us did it here. I did it a couple of times, and someone had a pan one day, and I thought, oh, fuck, I'm not coming back out if that's the caper that's going on. That's no. I'm going to close the door and not listen to that shit. I'll clap internally, thank you. That's fine. But no, once you bring pots and pans into the matter, you're just that's a toddler. That's not a grown up.
To be fair, I don't think the NHS were like, thank God. They're clapping for us.
I know.
What would we do without those cheers, huh?
Oh, those claps are going to pay my wages for the next 3 months. Oh, I'm going to love it.
Big up,
you tosser.
I'm not a Tory. I'm not Ryan Richards or Jim Skinner.
I wasn't calling you a tosser, but yeah, just a general.
All right.
Headline: Judas Grey outed as Tory. gets shunned on podcast. So yeah, when it started, then you said it wasn't that much of it. I was the same. It's like I'm not really an outdoor person anyway. I'm quite happy being inside. Every couple of weeks, I'd be like, no, I need to get out of this town for a night, just one night. Get me in a hotel in Aberdeen for 30 quid, and that'll do me. Just in our different four walls, but. It was the same. I played PlayStation. That was about it. I played the PlayStation. I tried Twitch, hated it, and did a podcast. And that's where we are 2 years later. So when it came to wrestling, though, you said you missed the gym. That was one thing. I know from other people I've spoken to, Joe was very attentive of just keeping his motivated some way or form and trying to like instill some wisdom as best he could. Under the circumstances.
Yeah, so we got like a few seminars and like online workouts and stuff, but from working out at home is a very different thing. So personally, I find it a lot harder than working out at the gym, like not just because obviously you're missing weights and stuff, but like the actual motivation to do it. Like if I go to the gym, I'm in the gym, I'm like, well, I'm here, I've got to do something at least. Whereas like I can do 2 push-ups and be like, nah, I'm not feeling it. Just gonna sit and do something else.
Right, you'll pick up some weight, and suddenly you're sitting on the sofa playing whatever on Xbox, and
yeah,
and that's it. It's all, how'd this happen? Here I am.
Oh no.
No, it was the same. But at least you get to discover some old games you forgot. Ratchet and Clank, I discovered during lockdown because I never played them when I was younger. And I was like, oh my God, this is the best games ever. Why did I not know about Ratchet and Clank? But is there anything that you found out, I don't know, find out about yourself during those lockdown times that for good or for bad?
I mean, mostly just how competitive that Warzone I was, to be honest. Me, my brother, our mates just played that all the damn time. Like, get home, immediately just go on Warzone. It's like, cool. And they'd be like, they'd be still having to go to work, and they'd be like, right, how long have you been on this? And I'm like, since like 10 a.m. It's now like 11 o'clock at night. And they're like, why? I'm because I have nothing else to do.
But speaking of that, so when you started your training, you're getting there for so 5 6 months into it. Was there any wrestling you were starting to watch for more educational purposes, things that you could probably put into your own work itself? Was there anyone that you looked for to find these little pieces to make Judas
So
Grey?
it was a bit like, because you have your own personal style with things. So obviously watching a lot of Jeff Hardy growing up, like Jeff, Joe would get us to do drills, and I would kind of just naturally do them the way I'd see Jeff do these sort of things, like whether it be how he'd run up the ropes for like a whispering wind. So we'd be doing like a British boot up, and I like the way I'd run up it and stuff like that. It's just, so I ended up watching more Jeff Hardy matches, but from a different point of view of just kind of being like, cool, let's actually see why this guy is over. Like, why is he so over? And then probably a lot more of Shawn Michaels. I think it made me a lot more appreciative of, like, I understood that everyone probably puts him up there as one of, if not the best wrestlers ever, but not having a single clue about actual wrestling, and then you watch it and I'm like, oh crap, like, yeah, he actually is shockingly good. Who would have thought?
That's a cool thing because like I've been saying, it's like when I started it, of course I got to discover a lot of these people. Shawn Michaels was a guy that I knew of. He was the, well, when I first saw him, he was the coked up commissioner. But when I actually saw him properly go, it was 2002 onwards, his return. So it was like, oh, Shawn Michaels, of course he's really good because look at him, he's done all this. And when you go back and watch it, like you've been doing, it's like, yeah, he is really good. Why am I surprised by this kind of thing? But it's cool that for someone like of your age that can go back and have all these kind of things available, YouTube and network and all that kind of thing, that you can just go, right, Jeff Hardy was cool, but he kind of modeled a lot of his stuff off of Shawn Michaels. What's Shawn Michaels like? Or Shawn Michaels modeled himself off of whoever. What was he like? And you can just go, there you go. In my day, I had to hope that someone had a VHS. Oh, and then be brave enough to ask for a copy of it,
The
and not
big
be
Ian
weird.
Skinner dream of just being the guy on a VHS that everyone trades.
Oh, geez, the back. I mean, when people like go like, oh, tape trading was the best time. It was piracy. Nobody seems to kind of not
Acknowledge
think.
that.
Yeah, exactly. Everyone kind of goes, oh, back in the day. All right, that's still piracy, though. That's what it was. Oh, it makes me laugh just to think
I mean, speaking of piracy though, like, do you remember there was, whenever you like had a DVD and you'd watch the DVD, there was this video that would come up before the film about piracy, and it was like, I can't even describe it, but as a child watching that video gave me more fear than 98% of the horror films I'd watch. Like watching this video where they're like banging on about how piracy is illegal, and it's like all these dodgy cameras. I was just like, I don't even know what it is. Like, I'm sorry.
You wouldn't steal a car. Like, no, wouldn't, but that's because they're heavy. I can steal a movie anytime I want. I've got LimeWire. I can do what? Oh, fuck, LimeWire. There's a throwback that I never want to. Like, I might curse this. If my Zoom goes down at any point, I'm blaming me mentioning LimeWire. Speaking of piracy, Sharky Fossil's got questions. There you go. There's a segue for you. Sharky Fossil has just some nice simple ones. When are you free to go dolphin hunting?
Literally whenever I don't do anything with my life other than go to work, gym, and train. So,
just hit me up.
Yeah, just hit me up.
He's also asked, favorite My Chemical Romance shanty?
Right. Now, you didn't explain this. So, obviously, there's a perception about me. So everyone just assumes I listen to all these songs, and we're on the Sharky Fossil ship, and we're chatting about how I don't actually know that many My Chemical Romance songs, and I was like, probably the only one I know is like what's that one about like sins and tragedies? I can't even say the word, and he was like, that's Panic at the Disco. And I was like, I don't know. I was like, I don't even know. I was like, what about like when I was a young boy? And he was like, that's my account. And I was like, I don't know. That's not my emo music. That's not my scene. So out of default, because it's the only one I know the name of, Black Parade is my favorite My Chemical Romance shanty.
So what is your emo playlist then? I'm assuming, is it just all indie stuff that I wouldn't have heard of? Because Panic and...
It's just that guy who's like, oh, I'm so underground, you wouldn't know this band. No. To be honest, it's kind of just a mix. Just think there's... You get like your emo rap and all your like emo metal and stuff like that. But like Kid Brunswick... he's the first one that comes to my mind. Early Youngblood, because it's just a lot grittier. I can't even remember them. I've not listened to that emo playlist in ages, to be honest. Like, it's really not that old. Like, the one I probably know best is All Time Low, the band.
Okay, I've heard of them. That's fine.
That I know maybe like, I know like two or three of their songs, and that's about it, you know?
But it's like you kind of pick and choose. I've heard of Youngblood. I couldn't tell you a song by him, them, it. I don't know what the proper pronoun for Youngblood is. That's about it. You kind of lost me with the first one. I was like, oh, no. You're going
to... To be honest, like I'm quite lucky. So I'm going to Reading Festival at the end of August. And Kid Brunswick is just like one of the acts on it. And I'm like, oh, cool. Just this guy I randomly found on Spotify, whose music I fuck with, and now he's just so happy to be at this festival I'm going to. Great.
Right.
My music mostly is just John Bellion, who's not emo at all. In fact, the only song you'll probably know by him is All Time Low, the one you see on all the TikToks, and it just repeats low, 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 like 800 times.
God, yeah.
I like him and Jeff Hardy, like fighting for top spot. My guys. But like obviously you get like Bring Me the Horizon, those like sort of rock bands. To be honest, it's mostly just the gym that has caused this. I did not listen to this much like rock and metal music until I started going to the gym and being like, grr, I lift heavy weights.
Is there one of those times where you just listen to all this like grr music and then suddenly you'll get I Can't Dance and there, and you're just like, this is the best day ever. I've listened to all this music, and I'm lifting now to Corbin Blue, and
I have videos of me. I have videos of me doing like deadlift PRs to Barbie Girl. I think the one of me doing my 200, it's on my Instagram like highlights, and I'm the one controlling the music in the gym. So in the background, you just hear a hardstyle remix of Starship from Nicki Minaj. And it's just me lifting this fucking bar. Fun for me.
Again, like much like wrestling, music is just, I've got like three playlists I have on my Spotify that I'll put on. I'll have like my wrestling one, which is all your screamy music, you know, because that's how I know it from. I know it from wrestling, and that's why it's in that playlist. Then I've got one which is, I call it my Giznep playlist, for those unaware. Disney look like Giznep and their logo. That's why it's called Giznep. And it's all my, it's Eye to Eye in there from the Goofy movie, bit of High School Musical in there, you know, so many. And then I've got a third one, which is Eurovision. And it's Eurovision songs. That's my playlist. They're my three playlists.
I mean, my main playlists are probably, I have one called Anger Leads to Hate, which is just like the heavy stuff, but the photo is just Anakin Skywalker after slaughtering a bunch of children. The other ones are, I've got my sad boy one, which is called Memento Mori. And then my main one is, it's really just to fix my God complex, and it's I Will Be God. And it's just songs that will do one of two things. It will either make me feel like I am the shit or make me feel like shit. No in between.
That's a nice Russian roulette of playlist, that last one. It's just, how's my mood going to be today? And then, Welcome to the Black Parade comes on because it's really My Chemical Romance song, and you're like, oh no.
There it goes.
I'm a terrible emo. I only know this one song by My Chemical Romance. Right. There's also something about Wrestle Carnival, but I've got questions about that, so I'll leave that for a bit. And he's put, where do you see yourself 1 year from now? And I will put to everyone, he spelled C-S-E-A. Keep it on brand. So where do you... I don't know, we'll leave that one to later as well. So those two ones we'll leave to later. You can think about that because they're two ones. They're round-off questions. They're kind of big questions to kind of end on. Got Liam Stewart asking if you could swanton off any historical landmark or onto any historical person, who or what would it be and why?
Okay, right. Do I have to be able to survive this, like, jump?
He hasn't said, so
just because I live next to the Forth Road Bridges, there's a morbid curiosity, because I always see, like, cliff divers, and I'm like, I'm very curious, like, could a cliff diver jump off and live? Because I have no concept of, like, height at all. It's all just really tall to me. So I'd swanton off of that just to amuse myself. Onto a person, I mean, a historical person? Oh, I don't know. I don't have any, like, grudges, I get. Margaret Thatcher. I know everybody hates her. She can get a swanton.
I can say you just want to talk off her because everyone else hates her. So, oh, okay, I'll hate her too. I mean, yeah. Good reason.
She's a Tory, I know that much. That's enough reason.
Boris, there you go.
Is he like a historical? He's kind of like,
oh, he's going to go down in history for something.
He's going to go down in history right now.
I don't know. I'm trying to think who else. Jesus. Is he a historical figure? Oh, God. I've went 100 there.
I feel like I'm definitely... That's some sacrilegious shit right there. If I'm swantoning Jesus, there's two things that are going through my head. One, if Jesus is here and this is Jesus, that means, you know, heaven and hell, 100%. Two, I'm about to swanton him, so it means I'm going to hell.
But three, if nobody really isn't sure what he looks like, you can just do it and go, well, I am Jesus. And then there you go.
Yeah, but what about afterwards? What about all the stuff after? I feel like when people are like, can you turn this water into wine? And I'm like, don't do that anymore, pal.
Exactly. They'll
just start questioning it.
You just start just begging it. You just go, it's like try and do Jedi mind tricks on him. You just go, no, you do not want wine.
You have a problem. Stop.
I cannot split this bread and fishes for 1,000 of you. You fucking serious idiot. You know, just wave your hands over it and again, just go, no, can't do this. Why have you got scars in your hands? Shut up. You know, so yeah, so maybe not Jesus then. That's our limit for the swantoning. Maybe not.
Anyone up to Jesus can get it.
All right, well, Major Matt Wolf with a bunch of questions before we get to the really big, scary one. But if you could wrestle anyone who is not a wrestler, other than Jesus, who would give you the best match?
Who would give me the best match? Oh, I don't know. Who would give me the best match if I was to wrestle anyone who wasn't a wrestler? surely it's got to be an actor, you know. Tom Holland.
Right. Let's follow up. Would you be dressed as Spider-Man? Or like Nathan Drake?
Of course. Of course. Like, that's 100%, that's his gear. Like, I don't care. He's not Tomb Raider. No. Man. Is it Tomb Raider? No, it's
Uncharted.
Uncharted. That was it. I knew I said that wrong. But like, he's Spider-Man. He's Spider-Man. I don't care. He's Spider-Man.
That's fine. So Judas Grey versus Spider-Man. That's the I'm in.
Oh, but all while saying that, Judas Grey versus Jesus, I feel like makes a lot more sense.
It does. You'd have to be the heel, clearly. You know.
No. Jesus, big heel. Big heel. Jesus.
I suppose it depends where it takes place. You know. I can't go down this road because
this is a rabbit hole. You don't want to go.
Yeah, I was going to say I want to live. I think if I start going, where is Jesus going to be a heel? I think I might it might go wrong very quickly. Yeah, no come back from that one. Let's just move on. So yeah, Tom Holland is who you're batting for that. Okay, right. Tyler Mortimer asks, why are you ducking Sharky Fossil, you lily-livered landlubber?
I'm not. I'm just, you know, good pals with my mans.
I'm more impressed.
Saying that, there's a gala day supposed to be coming up. I've forgotten where, because I only found out today. But who knows? Maybe I'll end up swantoning him there, to be honest. I've never actually hit a swanton, but, you know, someone's going to get it someday. It's going to be great.
That's the tease, is it? Once it finally hits, the place will just go banana.
Yeah.
Awesome. Right. Okay, well, let's get into your debut then. So, actually, before I do that, he's going to ask to remind you, or just to ask you about Josh Graham.
Josh Graham. He is an elite wrestler. Do you not know who Josh Graham is?
This will be revealed in a previous episode with Ian Skinner.
Oh, has he actually explained it? Okay.
Yes, he has. Fine, yeah. if you want your side of the Josh Graham story.
Basically, I'm a dumbass, and I can't remember names for the life of me. So I still don't even... Josh Graham. Who's Josh Graham supposed to be again? Literally can't remember. So it's Josh Graham. But yeah, it's just, I'm just stupidity. That's it. I can't explain it other than that.
I think he sang the song about sins and tragedies, so it's all good. It's right. to be honest, I recorded with Ian like a week ago and I can't remember. He just messaged me going, remember to ask Judas Grey about Josh Graham. And I was like, oh shit, I forgot what that was about as well. It was something, I don't know.
It's just me mixing wrestlers' names up. It was Joe was using someone as an example. And then I said the name and they're like, who? And I was like, but I said it with such conviction. That's the part that makes it worse.
So if anyone wants to find out that whole story, because neither of us remember what it was about, you can go check out Ian Skinner's episode and he will reveal all about Josh Graham and his prowess in the old wrestling world. Right, debut. So I've got February 2022. You've got your debut as Respect Pro Wrestling. I think it was the Wild Night Out, I think it was called, with Andy Weld on the show. And you were against Awesome Rob. So you would have had problem guessing your training matches and all that kind of stuff in preparation to getting in the ring. But what was it like finding out you're actually going to get a match in front of actual people?
So we were just, I think there was, for some reason, we weren't able to use our ring. So we were just kind of, we were taking a day to kind of run through characters and things we can do to get bookings. Someone brings up Respect, and so me and Rob actually don't wrestle each other that often, just because we just end up wrestling other people. It just so happens to be that way. And we found out, so it was a Saturday, it was the show. We found out the Tuesday night when Joel goes, just got off the phone, yeah, you've got a debut on Saturday. And I went, no, I've got work on Saturday. Luckily, the chef at my work is a massive wrestling fan. So I told him and he just went, you're finishing early. And I was like, but I actually wasn't that nervous up until the day. Like, I just didn't have any feeling about it. I was just like, cool. I have a match. And then I got there and it was like, it's just all sunk in. It was horrifying. And then everyone was like, yeah, no, just enjoy it. And I'm okay.
So, like, you said you're talking about putting together characters then. So, of course, a lot of the guys at Joe's school put out a load of promos during the pandemic. So we kind of got introduced to them in general. We didn't get, well, at least it does your kind of weak point. So I assume that's why you didn't really do a lot of that kind of stuff. But explain, for those that are unaware, explain Judas Grey.
I'm just an arse, to be honest. It's just, it's, I'm just a rather strange individual. I just kind of look a bit different to people. I run around in a skirt and a fishnet top and do fancy things. So I can be quite sarcastic and stuff. So when it comes to actually putting out a promo, unless I'm actually doing something, it's very hard to just kind of be like, yeah, I'm sick. Whereas you've got Ryan Richards, who's loaded with daddy's money and his big houses and fancy cars, and he can just do, hey, look at me and look at like this thing I bought, by the way. And like, did I tell you I was better than you? Because I'm better than you. And it's like, I can't really do that because I'm just a kid from the scheme who is just quite funny sometimes.
So there's fishnets and skirts off. So fishnet, I'm guessing, top Jeff Hardy. That's a pretty easy kind of one-on-one there. The skirt. So when I think of like that, I think of Raven. That's pretty much my first go-to for that sort of thing. But where was
it's
that from?
It's literally just, I was like, okay, I want to stand out. I want to be a bit different. What can I do? And I was like, you know what? I reckon I can pull off a skirt, you know? It's just a black leather skirt. I did get like a fancy one made, but it's like got all this like metal and stuff on it, and I'm like, I don't think I can really bump in that, to be fair. So I just ended up literally, it's like off of Boohoo, it's just a black skirt. And yeah, that's it. It's just, I feel like it just helps stand out, and it's just that thing of like, I don't really care about the general image. Like, I am who I am, I'll wear what I want. It's not, I don't care if someone's going to come along and like laugh at it. Like, when I made my debut, all the kids just like, why are you wearing a skirt? And I'm like, why not? Is there an issue with me wearing a skirt? Do you take issue? And then if they do, that's their problem, because who's going to come up and like try fight me for wearing a skirt? No one. And if they do, I'm fairly confident that I can, you know, actually win that fight.
I suppose if you've got someone that's as an inspiration like a Jeff Hardy, who's all about kind of individuality, and he never looked the same as anyone else on the roster, he always had this look, like not just the fishnets but the hair and the mad beard trims and all that kind of stuff. And yeah, I mean, as long as you're comfortable, I suppose, like say with the old metal thing, yeah, I'd probably be a bit more worried watching it going, oof, that's looks sear to land on. Again, now I'm old. That's the first thing I think of when it comes to attire. I'm going, is that practical? Is that practical attire now? It's like, skirt, of course it is. It's 80. That keeps you... So, right, that's the weirdest thing now I've got with watching wrestling is there's one thing I hate most is watching wrestlers without knee pads, because it just gives me the fear that I'm going to see a kneecap spin, and I don't want to see that.
I've still yet to wear knee pads just because I don't think it's... fit the assist. I need to get kick pads. That's what I need to get. I feel like that looks better with the skirt. I also have like these leather shorts, which I wore to Wrestle Carnival because Billy Hayes is on it, and he pulls off emo a lot better than me. He just has that aesthetic. Mm-hmm. Him and Sad Boy Inc., so which are class, to be fair, like top tier. They were great, but I was like, cool, I'm not gonna wear the exact same skirt, so I've got these leather shorts, still pretty gothy of me. Mm-hmm. I'll just pop these on.
It's not something I enjoy, knee pads. One thing that is somehow, if I see a guy just in their pants and shoes, that is their attire, you need some wrist tape. At least break the aesthetic that you're just standing there in your pants and so and shoes there. I need something just to go, oh, you're nae there, half naked in front of me. Just wrist tape seems to make all the difference for it. Something that just looks like bulky. I'm looking at it going, you must be sweating like fuck under there. I don't like it. I liked it when I was watching it when I was like 9 and went, oh, this is so cool. And seeing draws come out in a skirt, ironically enough. And he looked cool as fuck. And now I'm watching wrestling going, oh, that does not look comfortable. If you wear like a singlet and it's like a swimsuit kind of style.
Yeah.
And it goes right up the crack. And I'm watching it going, I don't want to watch this, but I can. It's the only thing I can see now is that, like, chewing the scenery, literally, at this point, and just can't watch it anymore. There you go. There's some fun facts. If you ever watch me at wrestling and I look a bit disgusted, that's why. I'm just judging people and their attire. But I like the skirt.
Lovely.
Whenever I made someone in 2K, generally, more recently anyway, it's always kilt. I always go for a kilt as my attire. Don't know if I could pull it off in real life as a wrestler, but in the games, kilt looks just looks cool.
Yeah. Cool. Like, that's kind of how it started off. And then I was like, no, it's just got to be a skirt. Like, it's just got to be. It's got to be something people at least kind of question in the, like, why the hell is he wearing that? That doesn't. And then just be like, why? Well, because I wanted to.
Exactly. Best way. So you made a debut at Respect against Awesome Rob. Awesome Rob defeated you in that particular match.
Big his ego up, Lauren. Big it up. It's fine.
But so
Rob, I hope Rob, if you're watching, I'm still better than you. Like one good match. Just say.
From the supreme Judas Grey there. So we talked about you coming into the match. So what were your thoughts afterwards? Was it just like, thank God the match is over? Or were you just ready for, because you've done it again?
It was, I hated it. Just the crowd didn't know who we were, so just kind of didn't care. So they're just so quiet. And there was this one particular kid who kept shouting at me. And I kept like shouting back at him. And I was like, shut up. And he just decided to listen to me, and I was like, no. I was like, what happened to shouting back? Why? Like, these kids were punching people earlier, and I've just told one of them to shut up, and he's gone.
Fair enough, mate. I'm not messing with a guy in a skirt.
I'm like, no, please. I'm very like perfectionist, and I personally was not happy with the match. Other people will say, oh yeah, no, you did well, and from a wrestling standpoint, it was good, this, that. But just, I personally feel like it wasn't my best match. That's it, really. I wasn't really happy with my performance. Mm-hmm. But all I could do was really improve, at least. So,
I mean, as long as you survive it, I suppose that's like one thing out of the way. Nobody's dead.
Oh, yeah.
Everyone's like kind of alive at the end of it, and so that just makes me laugh. That like, okay, just you told him sharp, and he did. I just I just imagine how awkward that would be.
it was horrible. I was just looking at him, just sharp, and just, right, cool. No, please, everyone, shout at me something, please.
Look at my skirt. Shout my skirt. Yeah. Do something. Oh dear. Right, so you had that one, and of course, you know, next match, obvious progression. First one being in front of a bunch of kids that were punching people, then you scared them into silence. Next match is clearly going to be a triple threat down in England for Wrestle Carnival.
Obviously, natural progression.
Exactly, with Joe Hendry, one of the best wrestlers in the country, possibly in the top 10 in the world, and Ian Skinner, who's very good too, and you'll appreciate me underselling him that in that particular moment. And then, obviously, that's a very big match to be put into. And then on the day, turns out it's not a triple threat match anymore. It's a singles match with the one of the best wrestlers in the world right now, Joe Hendry.
With that? Out the second rope.
Oh, okay, right. This is more intriguing now. Right, so before it became a singles match, when they saw that graphic go up, just yeah, how was that as an experience going, oh shit, this is quite
it
big.
It was really cool to see myself in a graphic. Like, just seeing it, I was like, oh, like, this is a real thing now. Like, properly. Like, I've been told, cool, you probably have this match. And I've been told, like, six different things. It was always changing. And then, like, I just went on Twitter one day, and I was, like, getting a bunch of mentions. And I was like, what the hell is this? And I was like, oh, crap. Like, they've put up this photo. And I'm like, I guess it's real now. This is a thing. It was just really cool to see the graphic, to be honest. Like, I have it saved. And I was like, I really should get it framed. And then the match didn't happen. I'm like, yeah, I could also get it framed.
So yeah, going in, Triple Threat was cancelled. I think Ian was saying it was pretty much on the day, on the journey down.
It was
down.
On the way down. Yeah. We find out, cool, singles now.
When did you find out the rope was gone? Was that just during the show? I'm assuming it is. It would just be beforehand.
Fourth match, Will Cruz goes to do a frog splash off the second, and it wasn't like slightly broke. It was the welding completely snapped. And I think you can still find the video on Twitter. He did a good job to recover, like, fully thought he was going to, like, completely snap his ankle or something. But he goes to jump off and it just goes. Which, so, that's, like, half my plan out my window. Like, okay, I can't touch the ropes now because they might snap. We're being told, look, we're putting them back up for like a bit of safety and general aesthetic, but, you know, don't be doing anything crazy. And I'm like, ah, cool. And then like all the matches afterwards as well, just contain people who would do mental stuff off the ropes and flippy stuff off the rope, who all had to then go, no. So that was a bit jarring as well. So
I suppose if there's anyone you could have been in the ring with at that point in a match where it's went from ropes to no ropes, it's probably not that many better than Joe to do it, you know, because you know, that's, he's got a bit of everything going on anyway, when it comes to style. So was he just like, we got this, and then kind of took you out there, or was he able to kind of just reformulate some of your wilder ideas into something that would work?
So I all my stuff was more like, okay, I can do this, I can do that, and we kind of like worked it out. Going out, it was just, yeah, we had the plan. You go out, you know, it's that classic thing of like, make the plan, execute the plan goes off the rails, execute a different plan, sort of thing. So he was really chill about it. We changed what we had to, and we went out and just did it. It wasn't as much as a hindrance as it could have been, but it was definitely, it took away from my personal like preference of things I would have been able to do. There was things I think I could have made just look a lot cooler had I been able to do something with the ropes, you know? But it wasn't that big of a hindrance. It was just quite a funny coincidence. It's like, cool, second match on Wrestle Carnival is now a singles match with Joe Hendry, and now you don't have a second rope. And it just kept adding and adding. I was like, cool.
So the third question from Sharky Fossil was, thoughts on your Timber Shivering Wrestle Carnival debut? That's what we're talking about now. I was hearing just loads of good stuff on the old, well, I was reading because I wasn't hearing, I don't have audio description on Twitter, but I was reading loads of just a lot of good stuff coming out of your match with Joe. And I think that was one that Joe get on the mic afterwards and the old handshake and big you up and big up the young
like
scene.
He explained how it was my second ever match and it was on Wrestle Carnival, and I think that's the part where people were, because no one knew it was my second match really. Mm-hmm. They knew I was newer, but I don't think they knew it was my second match, so that was the moment where people were like, oh crap, like this is his only second match and he had to do it here without ropes, with this, with that. It's like, oh, okay. And it was just really nice. Like, the crowd there was really responsive, which was really nice compared to Respect, where everything you're doing, dead silence. Yeah. There, people are like actually cheering for you. And it was like, okay, like people actually like me. But overall, I mean, again, this is what I mean with me being a perfectionist, is like everyone's told me it was good and I've heard nothing but good responses, but it still irks me because I know I can do better. Like, I know the nerves got to me with points. I knew there was parts I forgot, this, that. But like, I know that and it annoys me. So I know I can do so much better.
Yeah.
But I'm happy that everyone else seemed to have enjoyed it and it seemed to have gone off well.
And if you want to watch it at home, it's available on Wrestle Carnival. I don't have the website. I was really just kind of winging on a prayer there. But it's like Patreon. It's like $4.99 or something like that. You can go watch it back and see the whole thing unfold with Will Cruz almost dying. And then the matches afterwards. But there was
great matches. Like Ashley Vega versus, I think it's Chantel. Jordan, I don't know.
Was it Chantel?
Yeah. That was great. I love to see her. Like, we train with her as well, and seeing her progression on things we've worked on and like be put into practice. And I was watching this whole match, and there's one sequence I'd been waiting for, and it's her Euro sequence. And I'd been watching it. I was like, hit the fucking Euro. And she hit it, and I popped for it like mad. I was like, yes. same with Ian, like, obviously having to go from triple threat to the singles match and on first. So he got there and it was literally like, cool, I've got it. Hi. Here's the match. Here's what we've got to do. And he went out and like, that's my kind of match. Just like straight into the action. I loved it.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a good watch.
Yeah. Speaking of Ashley, I said to her when I spoke to her, because we did a chat way back at the start of the podcast. And then I spoke to her right about the start of this season. And I could not believe I was speaking to the same person, because it's just someone who's so confident and so willing to put themselves out there. And every time you see her put something up on Twitter, it's just like, who is this person I spoke to way back in 2020? It's Nate, the same person who's doing this now, because she's just so confident. It's ace to see. I like seeing the progression of wrestlers. I mean, that's why I like speaking to guys that are like yourself that are just starting, because not only because I can see how you are now, and then maybe when I'm doing season 5 or 6, if I keep doing the podcast when it comes back, now I'll speak to you again and you'll be totally different. You may still have a lot of the cool, chilled out factor, but you'll probably be, you'll have a lot more to speak about. But two, you might be a bit more confident, you might be a bit more articulate, you might have a bit more this than that. And it's a cool thing to see these progressions happen in like real time at the same time. So. Yeah,
Ashley's great. I love Ashley. Even watching her in training, like Joe push her to these limits where she thought she couldn't, and just watching her honestly work her ass off. And like, we'll have training matches with her. And I could comfortably say, like, me and Ashley could go on a show and like have a great match, you know? Look, she's terrified of my finish, which, fair enough, but you know, it is what it is.
Right, so I've heard, because I was speaking to Major Matt Wolf, and your question to him was, LFI
versus
LFI. Damn, that's so close. LFI. So explain the LFI to us.
Right. So this is the only time I'm going to explain this. So if I ever get like CM Punk'd and pulled up in a court case where I have to explain it, this is what they'll use. Basically, back when, again, was terrified of promos, I was being told, right, I need to shout more and I need to not swear. So I go to start and speak up and go, I go to say, let's go, and go, let's fucking, and instead of saying go, have realized as soon as I said it, screwed it up, and go, let's fuck it. And it just then became like the thing of, if I'm about to hit something, just shout, let's fuck it, you know? Which just pops everybody in training. So it just then became the LFI. It is now the let's fuck it. That's That is the whole meaning behind LFI.
And the move itself? Or is it, you hit it in Wrestle Carnival against Joe Henry. You know what? Don't tell us. But people can go and find out on Patreon. That's what they can do. that's what they'll do instead. So
good plugging.
Exactly. There we go. Right. So we've got a bunch more questions because that's just kind of wrapped up the whole, let's say, two matches. So that's fine. So we can get into the nitty gritty and the big question that everyone really wants to find out. But before I do that, we've got more. We've got Major Matt Wolf, favorite military battle of all time.
I mean, does the Battle of Stirling Bridge count? Is that like a proper military battle?
I suppose so. Honestly, I thought you were going to go something from the Attack of the Clone Wars. But, you know.
As much as I do love Star Wars, no, I'm going for the patriotic answer. That's what I meant. The patriotic answer.
We'll go with that one then. That's fine. Michael asked, you can erase any one match from history, either featuring yourself or not. I assume it will be the respect one in that case. Nobody will even know it ever existed. Respect one. Which do you wipe out and why?
I mean, if it is myself, it's going to be respect. But I mean, in general, it's like a match I hate.
You can just fuck up things entirely and go Money in the Bank 2011, CM Punk never wins the title.
Summer Punk never happened. Don't know what. I mean, even though that is like, it's a good match, I feel like you can't pick a good match. You have to pick something, people. You know what? Just because it broke my heart, the Brock Lesnar Undertaker Mania match just never happened. Taker didn't lose his streak to Brock, thus didn't lose it to Roman.
Fair enough. Okay, that's a fair enough answer there. Right, what else questions we got? And then we can finally get into DMG. We got Awesome Rob asking, what three stipulations would you just pick for three stages of hell?
Ladders, steel cage. Oh, and what would the third one be? Those are like my main two. Those are like my boys, you know? Probably a false count anywhere.
Okay, so that'll probably be first then, I'm guessing, in the whole...
Yeah, yeah. You fight into the ring, then the steel cage, and then the ladder.
That's not bad.
So I have to climb back out.
That's not a bad trio. I thought you were going to throw in, like, because we've already discussed tax, the 10,000 tack match. So if you've ever seen it, God, best no. Thing. No.
God, no.
Because I've missed it out from Matt's episode, I feel bad for doing it. Brent Carter... I asked him and ask you instead. Where does the general keep his armies?
Oh, God. He is filled with far too many. Far, like, the way he just comes off with all these, like, references, I'm like, the hell? Like, where? Where do you get these from?
Oh, okay.
probably in his new car since he just passed.
The general keeps his armies up his sleeves. There you go. There's the...
That is horrible. That is horrible. I'm glad you didn't ask Matt that. That was a horrible joke.
I know, I was so disappointed because I forgot. I knew Brent asked me a question and I saw it afterwards. I was like, oh shit, I didn't ask him at the time. But you know, I've redeemed it by asking it on your episode for some reason. Right, DMG. Let's do this. So... for those that have listened to all the podcasts so far, you should do this. Number 161. This is 161 when this goes out. In 158, we spoke to Ian Skinner and DMG came up for the first time, which Ian had said that he cannot be asked that. I think this question was when he's going to join DMG. Major Matt Wolf, then episode 160, was asked about... what was the best thing about being part of DMG? I think that was pretty much just of it.
He better have answered that, by the way.
He did. We had some tech issues, but he did answer it. I think the answer is complete. So, for those that are unaware, what is DMG?
Lovely. Right. Basically, right, when I was younger, my mom died. Gone. See you later. So, my humor since then has just been a very, very persistent, hey, look, I'm the little traumatized kid. I don't have any parents. Ha ha. So start wrestling. Find out I'm not the only person whose mother died at a young age. And kind of just because it's my humor, I made jokes about it. And Awesome Rob is actually the one who sent it to me. So I made jokes about, like, we're the deep mall guy, which obviously cut down DMG. And he sent it to me and he was like, oh yeah, we're now DMG. And I was like, what, damage? And it was like, yeah, that's the safe version of it. We are now damage. But what it properly stands for is dead mother guy, which is just great because, I mean, if it was going to be in it at some point. But it's one of those things of, like, so Major Matt Wolf's probably the newer member to it. And, like, he told me about how I have this really bad, like, dad joke about a dead mom. Mm-hmm. And he was like, that joke helped me through so much. And it's just, like, things like that. It's, like, one of those things where people are like, how can you joke about this? And it's like, because it happened when I was so young. Growing up, that is the norm to me. So people are like, how can you joke about your mom? And I'm like, I don't know. What's it like living with two parents? What's it like having a functioning household? Like, this is just how it works. This is life to me.
And people just use humor. I mean, I know myself. I'm quite a chilled, relaxed person. But generally, I use humor. I'll use self-depreciation.
Self-deprecating.
I was thinking depreciation, and that's the same thing, but different kind of tense. Self-deprecating humor, because if nobody can make fun of me if I'm making fun of me. And, you know, nobody can make fun of your dead mom if you're making fun of your dead mom.
Oh, I use that as everything. I was in high school, and I once, like, got in a fight with a guy over something stupid. And I just kicked him in the dick. And the teacher saw this in full view and goes, why'd you do that? And I went, oh, you made fun of my mom. And was able to just cry on command. And they were like, we both got detention. And I just left early. I was like, cool. Like, realistically, I just straight up kicked this guy in the dick because, well, he was an ass. I didn't like him. And he was like, no, I didn't do that thing. And I'm like, yes, yes, he did. What a horrible man. Get him in trouble, please. And they were just like, God damn it.
I mean, we're talking about members of the DMG, of course. I mean, I suppose obviously fictional Batman's in there, so, you know, it's everyone's,
yeah,
all the cool people.
Me and Batman, best buds.
Exactly.
Spider-Man, Jesus. Superman.
Oh no,
Jesus
mom was alive.
Well, now.
Oh yes, but yeah, we suppose, yeah, Jesus is part of the DMG now.
Yeah, exactly.
In fairness, yeah, the Queen. She's part of DMG. You know, they don't need to recognize it.
So it's an elite. It's an elite level club.
Exactly. Much how many members are going to get when she goes? Jesus, I mean,
you're gonna have your whole royal family.
I mean, you don't want some of them, but, you know,
yeah. All of them except for the weird ones. they get shunned.
Major Matt has also asked, who do you look up to most in DMG?
He's going to want me to say him because he's the tallest member, isn't he? He's going to be like, oh, I'm the tallest member in DMG, but. I mean, it has to be myself because I'm probably the best wrestler in that group. So,
fair enough. That's yeah.
They're gonna hate me. They're gonna be like, "You fucking, we put you over at ours," and I'm just going, "Fuck you guys."
But I mean, Matt thinks you're 6 foot 8. You're 5 foot 8 anyway. So that's,
you know what? There's this. So I've measured myself in centimeters and in inches. And I can't remember which way it was, but if I put it into Google and say it's centimeters, I think it was the other way around. So if I put in the inches into Google, it said I was 5'8". But if I put the centimeters in, said it was 5'10". But then I have friends who are like adamant they're 5'8", who are much taller than. And they're like, you're not 5'8". Because if you're 5'8", what am I? And I'm like, oh, well, that's good enough reasoning for me.
Right. I never thought of that when you said the centimeters thing and inches don't seem to work out when you Google it. I thought I was 6 foot for a really long time because I did it in centimeters. And then I measured myself properly and I'm 5'10". So it's, yeah.
Exactly.
I can get
it's
why.
It's all a lie. The Matrix.
I know.
It's light ones.
Life is a construct. It's not real. It's we're all.
I'm
similar.
Actually 7 foot two.
I mean, who am I to know? I haven't seen you actually wrestle live yet. I mean, who am I? I could be 7 foot. I don't know.
It doesn't even matter. I'm just like, if Adam Cole's 6 foot, I'm 7 foot.
Oh God, Adam Cole, the tallest, the shortest 6 foot person I've ever seen in my life. Right. So, last question I've got in this lot of things. Actually, no, I'm going to ask you my stupid ones first. I think that's more fun. Right. I don't know if you listened to any past episodes of the podcast. I hope you have. But if you haven't, we don't need to tell me if you haven't. I'd rather not know. Right.
I'm the one who asked the least favorite dinosaur, but you actively said, oh, he must listen in the Sharky Fossil one. And you just asked me that. The lack of continuity.
I've just proven that Ian's getting asked by Josh Graham, and I've forgotten that story, and I only spoke to him last week. So my memory is not to be not to be trusted.
Anything with me mentioned should be instantly put to memory.
So okay, then we'll ask. What's your favorite dinosaur?
Right. So, this is the difficulty. I watched Power Rangers, but my Power Rangers was Dino Thunder.
Yeah.
So does the red Power Rangers T-Rex from Dino Thunder specifically count?
You know, this question's so open that I've accepted some wild things in the past.
Or Spike from Littlefoot. I think that's what it was called.
That I'm happy with that one. But no, I've said wild things in the past. Obviously, obviously I'm Mighty Morphin because I'm old. But yeah, I was still a T-Rex. I've accepted Turkey Dinosaur is still up there as a great answer. Major Matz was, what was his? I think it was the Invisible Dinosaur. Do you think he saw us?
I'm gonna drop kick him for that alone.
So yeah, I've accepted a lot of tenuous links to dinosaurs in the past. So I think I'm all gonna look at it actually, because you know the Dino
I'm
Thunder.
Pretty sure it just that was my growing up. That was my shit.
Was it called
my brother was the blue. My brother was the blue. I was the red. There was the yellow, and then there was Tommy who came back as the Black Ranger, which was the big long neck dinosaur that I forget the name of. And then you had the guy who was the White Ranger, who was just like a pterodactyl, but he was cool as shit.
So. Oh, the dinosaurs, they look pretty cool. I'll give you that. That is pretty ace. Unfortunately, I don't want to say it looks better than the Mighty Morphin Tyrannosaurus, but that looks pretty fucking badass.
That was mine. That was my childhood right there. But they had like the cringiest morphers. They found rocks and it was like, it goes real well with air. Dino morphers, and they just smacked the bracelet with a big stone and it just suddenly morphed, and I was like,
I know, at least we got the cool ones where they just like pushed it into front and it's like shh.
Yeah, we just had mood ring fucking bracelets. That's what they looked like. They looked like something you'd see all the crystal people with now walking around being like, this is my healing crystal.
This is the one that represents the moon.
Yeah, this one represents the T-Rex because I'm actually the red Power Ranger.
Still not the worst ones. I think the worst battleizers, whatever the fuck they're called, was the Wii mobile phone ones.
Oh, you know, God.
There was like a Motorola Razor and yeah, they hit three buttons and then they were in the Blue Ranger.
Literally.
I can get in the bin. And the other question that we ask, what is your least favorite dinosaur actually? Just out of curiosity.
Favorite dinosaur. You know what? I probably had a legit I loved dinosaurs as a kid. I probably had like a legit answer to that. Oh, Barney. I can't stand Barney at all.
Right. When I did my top 100 dinosaurs on the website because I was really bored of it, and it was really difficult because one of them is Internet Explorer because I was running out of dinosaurs. Right at the bottom was BJ from Barney and Friends. Because I hated him. He was the yellow one with the baseball cap. It was the backward baseball cap.
I just could not stand... Actually, I do remember. I just can't stand Barney. I can't stand the whole show. Like, I remember watching it as a kid. And now I'm like, it fills me with rage.
It's just something predatory about him as well. Not just because he's a dinosaur. That would, yeah. Right.
Teletubbies. All those kind of shows.
I know. Sound a bit... Sound tweenies. you know, something just a bit off about them. Fuck, I'm going to watch all this shit when the time comes. This is, oh no. Dinosaurs, I'm all in for. Honestly, if it's not wrestling shit or Marvel stuff I've bought for this impending child, it's dinosaurs.
I'm a DC boy through and through.
Yeah.
I've got my scarecrow tattoo with like the bats flying around it instead of crows.
I've got one Batman tattoo and it's just this little.
Well, you know what? Like, if you're going to get any of the characters, at least you chose a well respected one.
Yeah. Oh, it's just nice because it's nice to do pixelated, but nobody gets this one. Oh, hang on. This one. Everyone thinks.
Right, let me try. So, Batman, Deadpool, the Mario one, Pokemon. I'm going to say.
That's Riddler for anyone else.
Riddler. It is actual hero. Oh, well, then Shazam. Right?
No, it's like.
If it's not Flash.
It's the Mighty Morphin Power Rangers.
Oh, but
nobody gets it.
And no.
I've stopped. I've really kind of given up explaining. Foco, oh, it's the Flash. All right, fucking this. Okay.
Mine all look really gothy, but they all have like really nerdy beanies. Like, I just got a new one. I'm not going to show it because I ain't got socks on. I don't think everyone wants to see my feet. I mean, some people might want to see my feet.
Keep that behind a paywall. Yeah.
Yeah. So I recently just got an anime one. So I've got Tanjiro from Demon Slayer. I've got Mikey from Tokyo Revengers and Levi Ackerman from Attack on Titan. I've got this woman, which has got a Mardi Gras mask. I will talk about tattoos endlessly, by the way, so you will have to shut me the fuck up. And like that little thing from the TV show Originals. I have this Reaper, which has a guillotine at the bottom in reference to John Bellion and his music, because he has a song called Guillotine. I have a big lantern that says Lightbringer on it because I'm obsessed with the TV show Lucifer. Like, love that show, all-time favorite show, and Lightbringer is like the rough translation of Lucifer into English. And then it's just filled with like a 13 for Friday the 13th and like Finnick Dick Hail, which means like God ends here and all that. So it's all really nerdy stuff.
I know, but you say that it all looks cool and gothic. My tattoos are We Are Groot, because I really need to fill that space. Spider-Man, Deadpool, a little Mankind / Watchmen inspired one there.
I respect that.
Of course, got the Mario stuff. I've got a little. I've got a skull with a Lucha mask on it, which I've called Iron Brucha because it's blue and orange. I've got the Hardy Boys symbol somewhere there.
Correct. Correct.
Let's see, I've got the word puzzles on there.
You've got the Avengers symbol inside of what looks like Captain America's shield.
That's it. Then I've got a Mickey Mouse. Because my wife's got the same, but she's got the outline version of it. And I've got it filled in. And then I've got a ripped Spider-Man bit there as well. So yours look cool and nerdy. Mine just look nerdy.
Mine look gothic. Everyone sees mine and just automatically assumes I'm a goth. And I'm like, yes, emo. But that's not why. I'd probably say I'm more of a goth than I'm an emo, because like, I appreciate the darker aesthetic, but I'm not quite like into super gothy / emo things. Like, straight up, like one of my favorite things is, so I have my mum's name tattooed on me, but I forget that when people see it, they don't know that. So like, Big Chez is the part, he just did not ask for about 2 years. And then one day it just came up and he was like, yeah, I never knew that. I just kind of hoped that it wasn't an ex-girlfriend. And I was like, no, I wouldn't have to be that dumb. But it's a conversation starter when takes and it's just Kirsten. And they're like, who's that? I'm like, my mom, who's dead. Did you not know?
She's part of a cult. She had to sacrifice.
Would you like to join? I can, that can be made. Arrangements can be made.
Where are we getting DMG merch?
You know what, right? As soon as I'm able to make merch, I will gladly make it, because first off, I'm just, if it's PG, it's going as Damage. Mm-hmm. And if it's like ICW, it's Deedmaw Gang, and no one can say anything, because what are they going to do? Proper heels and insult my mom, aren't they?
Oh,
that, where I can be a proper heel and everyone just insults my mum. which, you know.
That's childhood trauma that you really need there. 100 people, especially 1,000. That's a settle.
Just laughing. You're the most. Yeah,
you're really going to need to have a strong will at that point just to go, right, I know this isn't real, but oh my God, I've got 100 people shouting that my mum's dead.
My friends. I've just built this like humor into them. Like even at work, I will actively tune into conversation at the worst time on purpose, and it'll be like there was two people and they were just chatting. I was not paying attention. They went blah 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 mother, and I just went, and they're like, no, stop it. Just didn't say anything. I'm gonna tell you the dad joke, and it either goes really well with people or really bad. And I used this as a pickup line, and it worked. So, you know, so as we are fully aware, my mum is dead. If you are not aware, now you are. So that is the backstory needed. So someone once asked me where my mum was, and I used to say she lived in Cuba, like she faked her death and moved to Cuba. But for whatever reason, this time I was like, oh, I'm going to change it. I'm going to say Egypt. Like naturally just went Egypt. Show a bit of variety, you know? And they were like, why is your mom in Egypt? And just straight off this, I'm never going to top this. I could win every world title in the business and it will never top this moment in my life. Turned around and was like, well, you see, that's where all the dead mummies are.
Oh, there you go.
And it just all worked out so well, and it brings me so much joy to do that and have either like really, and I'm like, yeah. Or have the but like really, like
love it. That's a pun's always a winner. I've asked my second silly question, but it was absolutely worth it just to hear that. What would win the fight, two sheep or one cow?
One cow. I know you vote for two sheep, but it's just not two sheep, is it?
I've seen a video on YouTube that shows a sheep beating a cow. Two sheep could
You spoke to someone. You were trying to work out the name of the horror film with the sheep, and it was Black Sheep. I was sat there like, it's Black Sheep!
Did I say it was Black Sheep? Because I'm sure I said
I think you searched it up, but like, it, like not knowing it off the bat annoyed me so much. I was like, it's Black Sheep, why don't you know this? The zombie sheep thing. That's not really a zombie, but it technically is a zombie sheep.
Yeah, so Black Sheep. I had it on DVD. I didn't watch it. Right. So I don't know why I bought it. I think I was just curious more than anything, and then I didn't watch it.
As soon as it didn't start with Baba Black Sheep, you were just nope. Get
this
it off.
This isn't for me, no. To be honest, I'm tired. I think if I count them all, I'm just gonna be asleep. So last question we got from the Twitter was, did we get any through Instagram? I'm just going to double check. Oh, that Major Matt said one about inspiration, looking up to DMG. That was an Instagram special. So last one we've got through Twitter is from Sharky Fossil again. It's a nice philosophical one. We've already teased it earlier in the episode. Where do you see yourself 1 year from now?
I don't know. I don't like have this perception. I don't think that far in ahead. I'm kind of just like a day-to-day thing. I mean, ideally I'd like to have recurring bookings, you know, someone giving me ladder matches. Just give me a damn ladder match. Like, tell me if you, because you're up in Elgin, so the closest is you is what, probably WrestleZone?
Yeah.
Or maybe the one that happened in Inverness yesterday at this point would have been the
They come up once a year, maybe. SWA is the same, WTL is the same, but WrestleZone's
WrestleZone, like, you're telling me if they were like, here's the whole show, and by the way, we have X and X in a TLC match, you wouldn't be like, well, I want to see a TLC match. Like, I just want TLC matches. So in a year, wrestling a lot and getting TLC matches, just give me, I don't care who, you give me a damn broom. I will wrestle a broom. I'll do the Triple H, Kenny Omega, wrestle a broom in a TLC match.
There you go. That's, I mean, if you speak to Ian, he's got an idea for a show. I think that he may be able to do
that. You mean Ian Skinner's birthday bash?
Yes. The one with the hot soup.
Yes, we know all about his birthday bash.
So yeah, I'm sure you'll be able to fit in Judas Grey versus a Broom TLC match in there somewhere.
At least main event.
You'd hope so. Once he's woken up from his dream sequence. Right. So I think we've asked all the questions that I have on here. We'll go back to the cliche ones of is there any promotions that you want to wrestle in at all? Anyone that's on your list of places you want to get to?
I mean, promotion wise, the dream would just be WWE, like as a kid, just watching it. You know, opponent, Jeff Hardy, I feel like that's fairly obvious. But outside of him, I mean, Seth Rollins, I feel like I'd have a lot of fun with Seth Rollins, Kevin Owens, even like with AEW, Orange Cassidy, I think's great. I love him. I think he's funny as hell. Young Bucks.
Darby, I'm a spot in there fest somewhere.
Man. Darby, of course. Oh, that bump he took on those chairs was like props to that man. He is a bold, bold man. Props to him. Robbie Cardwell, fucking love Robbie. Me and him always message each other about having a TLC match with all these dumb spots and like him taking the tag bump because I'm low taking the tag bump. So ICW, let me and him have a ladder match and like absolutely rinse it out.
I like that. I mean, I like that it was like Jeff Hardy, Seth Rollins, Kevin Owens, and then Robbie Cardwell. And it's like,
he's just like, I met him before when we were at Respect, him and Sean. And even at the Martin Kirby seminar, like they're the ones I spoke to the most.
Mm-hmm.
And like, they just sound like, just get along great with them. I think Sean's taking a break just now. But Robbie, obviously on ICW and everything like that. But me and him just like get along well. Like we get along great, just doing all the, we just discussed doing all the stupid stuff. And I'm pretty sure Jeff Hardy's his guy as well. So let us just swan on each other. Let us do a trade-off, but with dives instead.
Before we round up then, I think I know the answer to this already, but I've asked everyone else this season. Vince McMahon phones you. You got your number. You don't need to know how. He's part of the DMG last year. I think he was...
Like he came and I was like, yo, bro, if you're gonna join, gotta let me sign up. So that's actually in a few years when I'm in WWE, it's actually because I allowed him to join DMG.
That was the trade off. So he's phoned you. He's went, thank you ever so much for letting me be part of the DMG, and all the perks that it brings. I want to give you the main event in WrestleMania as a thank you. You get to pick your opponent, your opponents, if it's a multi-man match, that's up to you. The stipulation, and they have to be alive. So it can't be my mum. Who are you there?
Mumma. I mean, obvious answer is Jeff Hardy and TLC match. But if it's main event WrestleMania, to be honest, I just want to steal the show. Like, that's most of what I want to do on shows. I just want to put on the most entertaining match. I would love to try and recreate like a TLC 2 sort of thing, like some madness like that. Get Seth in there, Kevin Owens, the Young Bucks, probably, and then what? Me and who would I love to team with? Oh, God. Who's like, so, me and Darby Allin. Me, Darby Allin versus Seth, Kevin Owens, and the Young Bucks in a TLC match.
And then, I mean, Jeff's got to be in there somewhere, isn't he? So are you putting a four? He's got the Hardys. Hardys is in there as well.
He can be my like special run-in.
Ah,
so okay. He's the leader. He comes in and does like some madness to take out everybody.
And then whips off his top. I got you.
Yeah, because I don't want him to. I want him to die. Didn't he just get pulled off of like AEW shows because he's like hurt? I'm like, no, don't retire before I can wrestle you, please.
That's fair. I quite like that. I quite like as a build up, you'd have Jeff just giving you all these tips and that what not to do, yeah. Probably, because I don't think he's ever actually.
And then me and Darby's completely ignoring it. Yeah. He's like, listen, right, trying to walk across the ladders didn't work for me, so don't do it. And then this time I do it and it fails. And he's like, fucking, what did I say?
Yeah, if there's two of them, make sure they're evenly distributed across the ladder tables if you're going to hit it. And then you just still hit one of them and everyone just slides off again.
You know what, right? Straight up, the scariest bump in that in the entire thing of TLC 2 is Matt getting pushed back off the ladder through the table. Because like going sideways, fine. You know, going over, fine. But going back, the space you have of which don't miss. And also don't smack your head off the barricade because you're now about 15 feet in the air. Go just. That's not going to work. So like that is the scariest bump. Any like sort of back bump like that is terrifying.
I don't know why it came into my head, but I was back to Royal Rumble. I think it was Royal Rumble 2000 with when it was like Dudley's Hardys, and there was a bit where I think it was Devon that was left to go through the table, and he was like lying on one a barrier, and suddenly he moved, and then all you saw at the corner of the camera was Jeff just come out of nowhere and just go right through it, and it's like the timing on that had to be impeccable for it to work.
So I think Devon was the first. I think Bubba was the last one to go through because
Bubba that was waiting there, but one of them was just like on the table and suddenly moved, and we're like, why?
Yeah,
there was Jeff.
Yeah, because I think he'd done the run, I think, along the barricade. Mm-hmm. I think he was doing that and then jumped and just went boom and just ate absolute shit. That's a great match. Honestly, I think that's such an underrated match.
It's a great pay-per-view, even if you had Endure Mae Young's tits. So, you know. With that, I think that's a good way to kind of wrap up.
Anything away from this, Mae Young's tits.
But if that's the lasting point you have in this show is just the mention of Mae Young's tits. That was my first show that I recorded off Channel 4 as well. Oh,
and that's the part where your mother walks in, and that's what like the GTA loading screen equivalent of the Royal Rumble is nothing but violence, and then Mae Young's tits.
It's just like
Billy, what are you watching?
I know. I watched them in the living room as well. I don't know why I'm still doing Mae Young's tits there. That was an awkward time. Anyway, that's not about me. This is about you. So thank you for joining me, Judas Grey, on this show. Where can people find out more about you and everything that you're doing?
My Twitter is at JudasMate, and my Instagram is just Judas Grey, but spelt with an E because I'm not Mingan, not American. Don't spell it with an A. I hope that's the right way around. Did we spell it with an A?
No, I think there's definitely a different shit.
It's Grey spelled with an A, and there's one spelled with an E. I spell it with an E, but I don't know which way the American way is. But I just like slating the Americans.
Right. Hang on. This is not the way we should end this podcast. Is me checking out the difference between Grey and Grey. So Grey with the E is more popular in British English. With the A is used mostly in American English. There you go.
Americans.
I think that, like, there you go. If it's not Mae Young's tits, it's up the Americans. We slagged off at the start. I think that was fair. Yeah, that's it. I think that's the whole show. Are you taking open applications for DMG, or are you quite selective?
Yeah. Just hit me up, and I'll go through the requirements, and you know, I'll get back to you in I'll get back to you within 5 to 7 working days, and then if you just send off the certificate and I'll get it all validated and everything, you know. We take our role very seriously.
Wonderful.
And okay. We also are taking applications for a mother on a pole match. So it's like the Eddie Guerrero Rey Mysterio match for custody over Dominic, except someone's walking home either without or with a mother.
If they gain a mother, did they get booted out of DMG?
Yes.
Fair enough. That's fine. That's the way we're going to end it. Thank you very much.
Thank you.